All linear functions are bounded, so Every linear functional here is also bounded linear functional, so x prime becomes the same as x star. Okay, then corresponding, if there is a norm, you can correspond with the norm reduces. So the question that, so therefore, if x, the vector, original, the, so if x star is such that x prime equal to x star, then the space same as this. Well, it's the same. So algebraic dual and the topological or the non-dual collapse into the same thing. Okay.
But this happens only for finite dimensional space.
So, but
we
okay, let's make a few statements first. Now let us take a finite dimension. X. Finite dimension. Case 1.
That case, this is a theorem which will prove later. What we will show is any norm, any two norm on X are equivalent. This is a fact. We'll look at it later. Any two norms are equivalent. What does this mean?
Well, basically, the main role of norm is the introduction of the convergence aspect. Just like modulus introduces the convergence, norm introduces the convergence.
That means when I say the two norms are equivalent, the notion of convergence is equivalent in both the norms. That means, if a sequence converges in one norm, it will also converge in the other norm.
So, this really means, what this demands, that if these two rules are equivalent, we must get xn minus x in one norm tends to 0 equals xn minus x in two norm tends to 0.
If it converges in one for any sequence,
whenever xn converges to x in one of these norms, it must also converge to the second norm and both ways.
That's what really we are seeking.
Now, when does this happen? Suppose this error can be controlled by a constant times that error. Then if that error goes to 0, this also will go to 0. And vice versa, if that error can be controlled by a constant times this error, then that goes to 0. So what really we need is this norm is controlled by a constant times that norm. And that norm in turn is controlled by a constant term this norm. So if we have constants A and L such that one norm is less than or equal to K times two norm, L times then this is just therefore, we take this as the definition of two norms being equivalent.
For every x.
So, we give the definition, two norms on a vector space are said to be equivalent if there exists k and l greater than 0 such that one norm is greater than k times two norm greater than 0. is what therefore to take as the definition of two norms mean
equivalent.
Now what we are saying here is if any two norms on the finite dimensional vector space, they are forced to be equivalent, which means convergence in any norm implies convergence in any other norm. So therefore the simplest way to look at coordinate space is then that will imply convergence everywhere. So in finite dimensional spaces, therefore analysis boils down to coordinate space analysis. That's all it boils down to. So this is a theorem. It's not a straightforward statement. It is a one way is very easy. We will show that, for example, take any norm on C. It's enough to take Cn because any finite dimensional space over C is just Cn. It can be converted to Cn by using a basis and coordinates. So any finite dimensional square or diamond dimension, take any norm on Cn. So if you take a vector x and I call En to be the basis, or Ej to be the basis vector, which has 1 in the jth place and 0 everywhere, the standard basis. Then what I can do is, I can write x as summation j equal to 1 to n. Okay, so let me call it as take any norm. So now take the norms on both sides. But the triangle inequality says the norm of the sum is less than or equal to the sum of the norms. So this is less than or equal to j equal to 1 to n xj. But the property of the norm is that constants can be pulled out with an absolute sign. So this is equal to summation j equal to 1 to n mod xj times norm. Now what do we get? Suppose maximum of norm P1, norm P2, norm P1. There are only n numbers. I take the maximum of these two. So I can pull out this m. Right? So that's the L1 norm. So therefore, see, that's one part of that inequality. And this norm is less than or equal to the L1 norm. Now, the other way around, that there is a constant this side also, is which is not trivial. Because we don't know anything about this norm. Take any arbitrary norm. So, we have this inequality. Norm x is less than n times norm. Now, let me call it as k, the same. Turns out there exists a k L such that L times norm x1 is less than norm x2. Whatever it is. And therefore, L times norm x1 is less than norm x2 is less than k. Which says this one norm is equivalent to any norm. You can take any norm on a finite dimensional space is equivalent to one norm. So the two norm is equivalent to one norm, P norm is equivalent to one norm, Suk norm is equivalent to one norm. So in finite dimensional spaces, all convergences are equivalent. If you verify convergence in one norm, you are guaranteed convergence in all norms. There is one advantage coming. This is what generally people refer to as the finite dimensional fiasco. Everything collapses into the same thing. We do a lot of things here, we are the finite, it's all the same. Topologically, they are all the same. Now that is not very difficult. I mean, at least some of the norms is very easy to see. Job, pictorial. Let us take, for example, two-dimensional stress. It's the real two-dimensional stress. Okay. Now, if you take any point, any vector in that space, that is a point having coordinates x1, x2. Now, topologically, we want to look at open sets. What is meant by open set? Neighborhoods of a point. That means, yeah, sphere. What are spheres in the two-dimensional Euclidean space? In the Euclidean norm, two norm, they are just circles. So what it means is, suppose I have a set which is open set in two norm. That means, given any point in that set, which is completely contained. Now we want to look at it in one norm. What is a sphere in one norm? It will be some kind of a rhombus, depending on not x1 plus not y1 is less than or equal to r. How does it look like? It's a rhombus, okay. So, but if you can draw a circle such that it's completely inside, you can also draw a rhombus which can. So if it is open in this, it's open in that. Conversely, if you can draw a rhombus, you can certainly draw a circle also. So if it's open in one topology, L1 topology, it's also open in the L2 topology. Similarly, look at the L infinity topology. You can draw a square about it. But if you can draw a square about it, you can also draw a circle inscribed in it. And conversely, if you can draw a circle, you can draw a square inscribed in it. So either way, all these norms are going to be equal. But these are some of the examples. But what this theorem says is, in general, any two norms on a finite dimensional space are equal. We have not proved it. Okay? We have proved part of it. We have shown that this inequality I can get. This inequality I am not sure. But it can be proved. Okay. So in finite dimensional spaces, all norms are equal. So what was I? Where was I? Any linear function. Then, as you can write x as summation j for any x. X belongs to x plus xj. What xcn? You take cn, otherwise take an arbitrary n dimensional basis. The one you need to get j. Any vector can be written in terms of the basis vectors. Linear function. Therefore, what is happening? By linearity, this is just xj plus ej. Right? So the modulus, the same argument is going to work now. Right? Now again, I take m to be the maximum of all this f ej. These are all now numbers. F association number with each vector. So these are all complex numbers. Take the maximum of this. So this becomes m times j equal to 1 thing and modulus. And therefore, we get mod fx is less than or equal to m times the 1 norm. And therefore, f belongs to it's a bounded linear functional in this norm. If you have taken the one norm to, if you have taken the one norm to the vector space, then this is exactly what we demand of the functional to be bounded. That is, the stretched length versus the original length must be under control. there is some hooks like that.
Okay.
So therefore, I have got boundedness in terms of one norm.
But we saw boundedness and continuity are synonymous.
Therefore, I get continuity in one norm. But if you get continuity in one norm, I have the continuity in any norm, because all norms are equal.
And therefore, if it is bounded in one norm, it is bounded in all norms.
And therefore, any linear function will be bounded with respect to any norm
on a finite dimensional vector
space. And therefore, on a finite dimensional vector space, all linear functions are bounded, and therefore extra collapses into algebraically equivalent. Is that clear?
Okay.
So therefore, we write it simple.
Sir, this equivalent of norm is actually an inference version of the equation of norm.
If you take the collection of all norms on a vector space and define a relation like this, and this is an equivalence relation, it turns out on a finite dimensional space there is only one equivalence term. All of them over fall in that one.
But in infinite dimensional space, this is not
so. So therefore, we have that in a finite dimensional space, there is no difference between the algebraic dual and the norm dual. But now what about infinite dimensional spaces? Now let me look at case 2, infinite dimension. What is mean by infinite dimension? That means the maximal linear independent set, which we call as a basis, any maximal linearly independent set which we call as a Hamel basis must be infinite. We mean all basis must be infinite in size. So therefore, any Hamel basis, what is meant by Hamel basis? Maximal linearly independent. Must be infinite. So any basis is infinite. If it's infinite, so let H be the Hamel basis. Let H be the Hamel basis. Or this normally. Non-linear space. Now I am going to look at the Hamel basis for this. Now since it is infinite, it must have a countably infinite subset. So, okay, now first of all, what is meant by Hamel basis? First of all, we have this fact. The problem with this Hamel basis is, we doesn't want to look at the geometry, it doesn't want to look at the topology, it all do only algebra. In algebra, limiting processes are not allowed, and therefore infinite sums are not allowed, and therefore if you want to express any vector in terms of the basis vector, it has to be only as a finite sum. So what does it mean to say that it is a Hamel basis? It is equivalent to saying this, corresponding to every x, in the vector space, there is a finite subset, let's call it as fx, in this Hamel basis, such that x can be written as a linear combination. So x is a linear combination of the vectors. So corresponding to every vector, there are only a finite number of basis vectors that matter. The rest of them are do not matter, and that vector can be expressed. In fact, that's a unique. It's unique where all the coefficients are not. If you want to add zero coefficient, you can go on adding extra vectors. So significant non-zero coefficient, if you want linear combination with non-zero coefficient, this affects this field. That's the first fact. Any vector can be written as a finite linear combination of the empty basis. Finite linear, that is the most important part and the most negative part of Hamel, that makes Hamel basis very unwieldy, because you don't allow infinite expansions. Right. The second fact is the following. This is nothing to if F we give arbitrary
we normally do. We have x1, e1 plus x2, e2 plus fk, xk, ak. What do you do for f of that? We say x1, f of e1, x2, f of e2, x3, f. These are all the f. And that is the arbitrary. So in other words, if you pre-assign the values, any arbitrary pre-assigned values, we can construct a linear functional so that those pre-assigned values are precisely the values taken at the basis vectors. That way we can get all the linear. So therefore, now I am going to construct, I am going to make a third fact. So this statement is a more general statement, not necessarily for linear functions. Linear functions. If we have a Hamel basis and if we have some linear things that are taking place, then you can construct arbitrary linear fellows by describing the values taken on the basis. That's all basically. So the action on the basis determines the linear. Determines the entire linear function that we are talking about. Okay. So that's the second fact. The third simple fact is the following. See, H is infinite. This H is infinite. It must have a countably infinite subset.
It must have a set. Call it as H1, H2, etc. Call it as.
So effects will be unique for a given name.
Pardon me?
Effects will be unique for a given
name. Yes. Provided you demand that the coefficients be non-zero. If you want to have zero coefficient, you have to simply get one more vector and put 0 term. But effect is unique.
Yes, certainly.
That's what I said. If you demand non-zero coefficient, then it is okay. Otherwise, there you can have zeros. So, since x is infinite, it must have a countably infinite
subset.
So, I can write h as x naught union h naught complement. Where h naught complement for me is h minus h naught. Remove this h naught, the remaining vectors are all called h naught complement. Or if you don't like it, let me call it as h complement, call it as h one. H one is h minus h naught. All the remaining vectors. Take comfortably infinite subset of h and the remaining vectors we call as h one. Now I am going to construct
the linear function of f as follows. Let me, before that, let me make one thing even easier.
Now these h1, h2, h3 are they linearly independent?
Yes.
Yes, because they are a subset of a linearly independent set. H is a basis. Now, if we have h1, h2, hk are linearly independent, can they be zero vector? Can any one of them be zero vector?
No chance.
So, all of them are non-zero vectors. And therefore, all of them are non-zero norms. Therefore, if I divide, what can I get?
I will get a unit vector.
And now what can I say about this?
This will also be a linearly independent set.
If h1, h2, h3, hn are linearly independent, h1 by norm h1, h2 by norm h2, hk by norm hk will also be linearly independent. And therefore, without loss of generality, assume norm hk should be 1. That we already done. That normalization to length 1. Without loss of generality,
you can take them to be, if they are not unit vectors, divide them by the unit vectors and take them to this.
And replace those base vectors by these base vectors. And construct a new basis where we have this countably infinite unit vector subset.
Okay.
So without loss of generality, that's what is the very, very fantastic statement, without loss of generality. All these things can be done.
Okay.
So now, construct a linear functional on x as follows. Now by 3, to construct a linear functional, this is 2, by 2, to construct a linear functional is enough if I tell what it does to the basis vector. The rest of it is automatic extension. Once you define it on the base vectors, you extend it to the other vectors by this. Okay, take the linear combination and look at the action on those basis vectors which appear in the linear combination and take the f of them and that's it.
Okay.
So that's what we are going to do. Take any vector x, the moment I know this, take any vector x, look at its expansion, look at the base vector involved in it, replace that by the action of f on the base vector. That's how the linear function is happening. So therefore, by 2 is enough to say what f does on h.
So now we say what f, what is the action of f on the basis vector.
Now what I am going to do is, now we define f of hn to be n.
f of hn to be n,
and f of x equal to 0 for every h, 2h1. The other portion I define it to be 0. So now what happens? So if you look at f of hn, which is equal to n, which is equal to n times norm hn, because norm hn is 1. So therefore, mod fhn by norm hn is equal to n. Now what does that say?
It goes unbounded, because n goes on going to infinity.
So therefore, supremum of mod fx by norm x must be greater than or equal to n for every n. Because this is one of the possible values in this ratio, and therefore it must be greater than or equal to n, which implies f is non-positive. So therefore, on an infinite dimensional space, there exists unbounded linear. Therefore, this x star will be contained in, is a linear functional.
It's bounded, but x prime consists of all linear functions. This consists only of a small portion of that.
So, to bring in the topological thing, you have to ignore some of the linear functions. But this problem does not take place in finite dimensional spaces, because in finite dimensional spaces, a linear functional is bounded with respect to the one norm. But then, once it is bounded with respect to the one norm, since all norms are equivalent, it is bounded with respect to all norms, and therefore, in any finite dimensional non-linear space, any linear functional will be bounded. But in infinite dimensional spaces, there must necessarily exist. See, you can construct many more norms. For example, if h itself was this, out of infinite, then the h1 data. Then what can we do? You can take h1, h3, h5, h7 and make them one, and the rest of the places are another linear functional. Or you take any arbitrary infinite subset of it, define it to be n and the nth vector n and the remaining is 0. You will get any color. Concept 1, there are many. If f is an unbounded linear functional, 10 times f is also an unbounded linear functional. So there are many, many unbounded. So the existence of 1 was essential, and this follows from the fact that there exists a Hamel basis, and that's axiomatic. So there is somewhere along the line, every vector space has a basis. The Hamel basis is dependent on the axiom of choice. So that fellow is sitting somewhere here in all these things, that there exists an unbounded linear functional, also is a consequence of the axiom of choice. Example for a countable, take the space of all polynomials.
Okay. 1x, x squared, x cubed, x to the power of n, etc. It's a Hamel basis, because any polynomial is a finite linear combination. And for every polynomial, there is a unique subset of this which I expect. Okay.
More interesting question. Think of an example for uncountable Hamel basis.
Sequence spaces, you don't have a
problem. What is that? You think about my question, you will know the answer. Think of an example, think for a day. Think of an example of a vector space which has an uncountable Hamel basis. That is the real thing, to show that the Hamel basis can become very, very unmanageably big. See, first of all, again, keep repeating this question.
Why do I want to look at basis? Because I know that basically, if I know the basis vectors and what is happening there, I can reconstruct what is happening to the other places because of the linear composition.
So therefore, these linear actions are all like, the basis vector is like sampling. You see what is happening to this base vector, I can now tell you what's happening anywhere else. So therefore, what is the idea of sampling? I want to do less work. I can't go on asking everybody, whom did you vote, whom did you vote, whom did you vote, whom did you vote. Then actually I am conducting another election. So the Gallup poll is a bit of sampling. So I want to take the basis vector as a good sample. Exactly I can tell you afterwards what happened. Okay. But if my sample is huge, then sampling is useless. Now that's what happens with the problem with the Hamel. In some cases it is nice, but there could be cases where the Hamel basis could become uncountably big, which means it could be as big as the space itself. The space also would be having uncountably infinite number of vectors, and the basis also is having uncountably infinite number of vectors. So instead of sampling, I could as well go and look at everybody independently. Okay, there's not great advantage I'm going to make. So that's the one. Construct an example where the Hamel basis becomes useless. It becomes uncountably big, the space is uncountably big. Think of your sequence spaces.
Space okay. Of all functions.
Huh?
Space of all functions between 0 to 1.
Yes.
So the Hamel basis will be
uncountably. Hamel basis will be?
Uncountably.
You have to show me why. you are right, you may be right, you may not be right, I am not giving the answer. Okay. Think about it. You may be absolutely right. He had sequence spaces, you had function spaces. Now, sequence spaces are nothing different from function spaces. You're looking at functions defined on a discrete set, and you're looking at a function defined on a continuum. They both may be talking the same thing. So, now put them together and see why it is uncountable. You have to demonstrate that it is uncountable. So, what does it mean to say that you have to demonstrate that it is uncountable? You must generate an uncountably infinite linearly independent set. So any maximal linearly independent set must be at least of that size. So therefore, so you have to either in your function space or in your sequence space try it. What is the answer in your function space?
If I choose a function fn of the form that 0 everywhere but 1 at that
time. Exactly. So take the characteristic function of the singletons. Take the space of all functions on 0, 1, real valued functions on 0, 1. And look at this set, the characteristic set, call it as fx. It is function fx where x where is 0, 1, where fx t is equal to 0 if t not equal to x and 1 if t equal to t. Correct. Okay, take the characteristic function of singleton point. How many functions are there? As many as there are points, let me speak. Are they linearly independent?
Yes.
Yeah. So the Hamel basis is huge. It is as big as the space of functions. Well, of course. Still not demonstrated. It's an uncountably infinite. This is not a Hamel basis.
This is uncountable.
Therefore, the maximal linear element must be at least as big as this. So, no Hamel basis can be smaller in size than C. Okay. So, if at all anything, it will be bigger than the cardinality of 0, 1. And the best case will be it will be equal to the cardinality of 0, 1. So, you already have a case where you must have a Hamel basis, uncountably infinite. Pardon me? You think what you will do, okay?
But
you can't use this in sequence.
So, if the space of all functions, cardinality of the space of all functions
is 2 to the c.
Is more than the cardinality of the basis.
So we have still not established that the Hamel basis is this.
Okay.
Right? You have simply said this is a linearly independent. At least it gives us one answer where the Hamel basis can be very huge. It's not just small. Sampling becomes extremely difficult, okay? That's the idea. That is why we get into this. Precisely the reason why you bring in the topology into the account and start talking about different other types of bases. Not he more or less we drop dead whenever we are dealing with function spaces. We drop the Hamel basis dead and look at other types of bases very good. Hello. The problem with the Hamel basis is that you restrict everything should be finite linear combination because you want to stick only to algebra. You don't want to do topological limiting processes. So there, that constraint puts you makes the basis larger and larger. But suppose you allow limiting, so I don't want that just finite linear combination. I will also allow infinite linear combination, provided I can talk about convergence. Then maybe I can compromise on finite linear combination. So I must be getting something out of my compromise. The thing that I get is shrinking the size of the basis.
On space of L1 functions, you can have
e power omega t
with base
entry. Pardon me?
On space of L1 functions,
e power
I omega t with base
entry. See, okay. Now, that's a different ballgame. Let me, this is a very, very, very huge question. Basically, the question of basis was the fact that, okay, I will just say something very loosely, because again, I thought of just what sort of things that would happen. Now suppose I have a non-linear space. Okay? So the best thing, I'm going to take it very, very, very intuitively. If you want to now forget about Hamel basis and use the fact that I can do infinite series also, then the next best thing that I would ask is, okay, finite basis I cannot have. Then it becomes finite dimensional, then everything is gone. So suppose the next best largest size is, suppose I can get a sequence of vectors in x. Okay? Such that every x can be written as where convergence is in the norm. What do you mean by that? That is, okay, that's the next step. Now we had only finite linear combination, now we are allowing infinite linear combination. So u1, u2, u3, etc. are linearly independent vectors, and I have an infinite linear combination allowed, then I am able to take, suppose this is possible. Now let me look at it as many as this. What does this mean? This means that any vector x can be approximated as accurately as you want, but finite linear combinations of UG. Okay? So, again, we somehow put the point. So, this is the same thing as saying any vector. Okay. So, another way of looking at it is any vector x can be approximated within any epsilon positive by finite linear combinations of the invertors. Right? Now, this means the following. This means finite linear combinations. That is the advantage of teaching a course which does not have a syllabus. You can take the lead from the questions and go in whatever direction you want to go. Syllabus, why is it? You have a straight track. Finite linear combinations of u vectors is a dense set. Anything can be approximated any accurately from that dense set. That's what. So finite linear combinations approximate anything within any error. Therefore, the finite linear combinations form a dense set. Now, If you take a finite linear combination, let us say first real, all coefficients are real, then I have finite linear combination.
Let us say first k only, just for the,
it may be some other I1 and then I2, ui1, ui2, uik. Not necessarily first k, someone here, someone here, someone there.
But for sake of simplicity, I am writing the first k.
Then, this fellow can be approximated by a rational as closely as you want. This scalar can be approximated by a rational number as closely as you want.
Right? So therefore, I have a rational linear combination
which approximates this as closely as I want, which in turn approximates this as closely as I want. So this means rational finite rational linear combinations of u vectors form a dense set. Okay? Form a dense set in X. But how many finite rational linear combinations are there?
Only countably infinite number.
So therefore, we have a countably infinite dense subset. Therefore, this implies there exists a countably dense subset. This implies what?
That space,
what we call as separable space.
A priori, you need a separable space to do this.
A priori. Pardon me?
No, no, let me go through the whole thing.
So suppose this happened, you cannot even ask this question in this case. So, okay. So, let us say we are taking limiting processor also. So, let us without even making much fuss, let us start with the Banach, which is a complete nonlinear space. If such a thing exists, the uj is called the Schroder-Bliss. From Hamel, we have gone to Schroder-Bliss.
The difference between the Hamel basis and the Schroder basis is, Hamel basis demands that every vector can express the finite linear combination of the basis vectors. The Schroder basis demands, only ask that every vector can be expressed either a finite or an infinite linear combination of this basis.
Now what we have seen is that X Banach space has a Schroder basis implies X is separable. Implies X is separable. So this question doesn't even make sense for now. What happened was they looked at all the standard classical separable Banach spaces they knew
and see whether the converse is true. Is yours. That
is this true? Is the following true? X separates the Banach space implies there exists a Schroder basis. So that's the point.
That's it. Yeah.
So the mathematician, whenever he asks the question, the first tendency is to construct an example where this is false.
Okay. In fact, I remember the classical theorem on Fourier series that if you have a signal with finite energy, that is if it's L2 or 0 to pi, that the Fourier series converges almost everywhere. So whenever you have L2, you don't talk about point-wise. Point-wise means almost everywhere. Sets of measure 0 are irrelevant for us.
One result known was that in the norm, correct norm, the energy norm or the L2 norm, the Fourier series converges. But since you have a series of functions, there is also this question of point-wise convergence. So this question about, does the Fourier series of L2 function converge almost everywhere? Any L2 function converge exists. This question came up because Kolmogorov constructed an L1 function for which the Fourier series diverges at every point. So it's a rather remarkable, killing example, which more or less has a tremendous amount of gloom in Fourier analysis. There's no hope like point-wise convergence at all. Every point the Fourier series diverged for a constructed an L1 function. So therefore, the question the next was what is interesting is finite energy or whatever it is from the point of the observation. So L2, it's a special thing. Hilbert space, something nice must be happening. So the question remained, does the Fourier series of every L2 function periodic 0 to pi converges almost everywhere?
Now apparently this problem cropped up again and again, and
there was a very famous mathematician,
Zygmund, he is a very famous man in trigonometric series, outstanding analyst.
He had a student by name called as a student, then later co-worker, and then later a very outstanding mathematician, and who won the Abel Prize last year also, 2006 Abel Prize was won by this man by name Carlson. This Carlson, Zygmund went on egging him, you construct a counter example to show that there is an L2 function whose Fourier series does not converge almost everywhere. So Carlson says this is the trend. Zygmund was an outstanding man who could construct beautiful counterexamples. So he went on egging me, construct a counterexample. Then Carlson writes, says that I went on trying, and the more and more I tried, I realized that if at all I should construct a counterexample, it must be like this. Then I realized it cannot be like this. And actually I got a proof that the Fourier series of an L2 function converges on. See, it's the construction of the counterexample led him to the proof that there is no counterexample. It's amazing. I mean, all that manipulations with the examples really gave him a complete inside picture of what is going on. And then he realized, if I put all these things together, what's going on, I'm actually getting a proof that it converges almost everywhere. So he proved that theorem, the famous theorem of almost everywhere convergence of an L2 function in 1964. But within two years, another young man in his PhD thesis showed that for any p greater than 1, it is true. The Fourier series of the LP function converges almost everywhere. Okay. So that was a phenomenon which Klutz waited for so long. The moment L2 was proved, similar ideas were used and LP was finished. Amazing, Carlson didn't think of even going from L2 to LP. He was so excited, I think he did. But before he enjoyed it and came back to look at it, this young man had written a thesis that LP also it is true. Okay, incidentally that Carlson went through this sort of thing, I learned from this other person who proved the LP, Richard Hunt, who immediately after his thesis was appointed as an associate professor in the university where I was studying. So I had an office almost right next door to him. So I could do a lot of, learn a lot of things from him. And that's when he was trying to tell me about this business of constructing counter examples. How it helps you to understand the problem, and sometimes it may lead you, actually there is no counter example, there is a theorem. That's that sort of thing. Okay. So therefore, people started looking at here all the known standard separable Banach spaces. Okay. You will be surprised that the first nice separable Banach space is C01, the space of all continuous functions on 0,1, because polynomials with rational coefficients by Weierstrass's theorem form a countable dense set, therefore that's a separable space. And what about the basis for that? And then, various other classical Banach spaces. Now, for every one of them, they could construct, actually physically construct a Schroeder basis. So the more and more examples they took, and every one of them was succeeding. So there was a belief that there became a conjecture that every separable Banach space has a total basis. And then there came a theorem. For example, if it was a Hilbert space, suppose let's take a special case, separable Hilbert space. It's not only a norm, but the norm is induced by an inner product. Then in an in a separable Hilbert space, there is always a complete orthonormal sequence. The moment you have a complete orthonormal sequence, that's a Schroeder space, because everything can be expanded in a general Fourier series. So therefore, the answer was yes in separable Hilbert space. It's simply the classical Fourier series generalized instead of the exponent e to the int, use a general orthonormal set which is guaranteed existence of an orthonormal, complete orthonormal sequence in the separable guaranteed, and therefore you are true. So therefore, separable Hilbert space, the theorem is true, so it must be true. It is very likely it is true. And all classical Banach spaces that we know will be separable. We could construct, so it's more likely it is true. Then came, I talked to you about reflexive Banach spaces. That X can be completely embedded into X double star. Okay? When you have such a space, the answer was true. That's why I said a reflexive Banach space in a masked way behaves like a Hilbert space. Okay, therefore, if that was true, there could have come that masking, if you do it, you get the result here also. So therefore, more and more faith started appearing. So it became a religion that every kind of basis has. Every separable Hilbert space has a Schroeder basis. But again, in 1976, the Swedish mathematician showed that this is false. There are separable Banach spaces for which there is no Schroeder basis. This has a connection with approximation of compact operators for finite rank operators and so on and so forth. There is a lot of interconnection between integral equations, compact operators, etc. etc. And he showed not necessary. Are not true in general. Maybe true in special cases like the examples constructed, but in general it is not true. He won the Fields Medal for that. And Cardason won the Fields Medal for the Fourier series too. These are all outstanding problems and analysis. So therefore, this basic problem is not a joke. It's been hanging around for so in other words, still we do not know a theorem. See, now we know that separability alone is not a sufficient condition. Separability of the Banach space alone is not a sufficient condition. What is the additional small extra you need to guarantee a Schroeder basis? Answer, not known.
So in identity space,
yes.
And it will be greater than 1.
Yes.
Fourier series.
I mean,
okay.
See, in a finite dimension, see, first of all, let me, if you look at, let's look at, let us look at Fourier series. Suppose you have a function which is in 0t. Okay?
So, can that
0t
be generalized to a finite dimension space?
The more complicated. Multiple dimensions we can talk about like Rn or things like that. But beyond that, more complication. Yes, you have to talk about, you know, even in probability theory, if you're talking about Fourier transform for distribution. Distributed, which you call it a characteristic function, various names are given for that. So there are generalizations of this, it's not a, but there again the questions of convergence, etc., all in those places, it's enough they have probability convergence or something like that, they'll get away with it. But the classical question is about almost everything.
Because apart that this whole business of Fourier series has been generalized with abstract things like harmonic analysis, similar questions will arise. And in fact, you can replace the zero t by a finite group, finite abelian group, and talk about Fourier transforms on a finite abelian group. All kinds of generalizations. Okay. See, the 0 to pi, you can think of essentially the circle. Okay? So the e to the it is some sort of, it makes it a cyclic group, e to the it, e to the it, e to the it, and then you finally come back to that cycle, okay, e to the correct in or whatever. So you keep going around that cyclic group. So now we start talking about what we are trying to do is, we are trying to take a product with a cyclic thing in that circle group and try to recover the function. So somehow the other we are saying, I will give you a discrete information about the function, give me that function. It can be used, you look at it as a function on an interval, function on a group, function on an abelian group. All kinds of generalizations are available for this, and harmonic analysis is the subject, that subject. And Carlson is one of the men responsible for making it. But this Abel Award is mainly, citation says that it is mainly for not only his Fourier series work, but then pushing things to a group. Now what I said about LP was the following. Suppose you had 0 t and basically the entire Fourier series, the first problem is how do I define the Fourier coefficients if I do it in terms of the exponential. This will be my Fourier coefficients, what notation I use, Fn. Then the Fourier series I write in this. The questions are, first of all, is the series well defined? Secondly, if it is well defined, does it convert here? And if so, in what sense? Now, first of all, well defined means are the coefficients properly defined? The coefficient property depends on the integral property. So, if f is in L1, it is all well defined because mod of this is less than or equal to mod of this, and that is less than infinity, everything is fine. So, one thing is f is in L1, it is all okay. So the series is well defined. And now the question is about convergence. So if now the f is in L2, it is automatically in L1. Remember in finite metric space, subsequent L2s. And therefore all these make sense. And what since Kolmogorov said pointwise no here, the question next is L2. And Carlson said yes. You get almost everywhere. Pointwise. And what Richard Hunt did was, well, still, if f is in LP, p greater than 1, it is in L1, and therefore still this is well defined, all the questions make sense, and he said that is true. Yes, that's essentially right. So, that's the, there's a lot of problems about this basis and which are still unresolved. So if you think that we all know about basis, no, there are lots of questions about basis. For example, what is the appropriate, necessary and sufficient condition for a separable Banach space to have assured a basis? We do not know. We know that to have a Schroder basis, separability is a necessary condition, but it is not. But what Enflo's result proved was that separability is not a sufficient condition for the Schroder basis to exist. The infinite dimensional spaces one thing is the easiest ones are the Hilbert spaces. They are easy to handle. But slightly other from the Hilbert space, the next best, well, the common theme is if the next best is reflexive Banach spaces, okay, they are little better off than the normal Banach spaces. So, if they are working on a Hilbert space, your life is much more comfortable. But the next level of comfort is reflexive Banach stress. But if you are working in a general Banach stress, that is more complicated. And if you are even working at an incomplete nonlinear space, life is even more complicated. So the level of difficulty depends on what sort of space. In other words, if you are solving problems like partial differential equations, differential equations, etc., the question is where you are looking for your solution, what sort of functions. If that function space forms a Hilbert space, fine, good theory is available. The function space forms a reflexive Banach space,
yes,
reasonably good theory is available. If it forms a Banach space only, well, something. So if it doesn't, if it's a nonlinear space only, it's not complete, then there's more problems. If it is not even a nonlinear space, it has only semi-norms, then all these Sobolev spaces and other things come. Things get murkier and murkier, and results are not that clean and neat.
Okay.
So naturally, the effect will be less.
Sir, is there no notion of linear independence taking infinite
number of numbers? That's why we define any set is said to be linearly independent. If every finite subset is linearly independent.
But there is no notion if you want to consider infinite of them at a time.
As an algebraist, no. But as a topology, again this, if summation xi ei equal to 0, then xi must all be 0. So that's essentially what the Schrodinger question says. So if you want to talk about infinite linear, first you must put a convergence concept. Then only you can talk about it. So in algebraic sense, no. In algebraic sense, that is why in linear algebra, when you are doing linear algebra, the way they are defined is, we will have to define a basis is, first we will define the finite set of vectors is said to be linearly independent in summation ii alpha equals 0 n plus alpha equals 0. Second step, an arbitrary set of vectors is said to be linearly independent if every finite, reduce it to the previous case, if every finite subset is linearly independent. Third step, every vector space has a maximal linearly independent. First step, any two maximal linearly independent sets have the same cardinal. Fourth step, any maximal linearly independent set is called a Hamel basis. And any two Hamel basis have the same set. And that's called the dimension, Hamel dimension in that space. So algebra will always come, reduce the problem to the finite. Linearly independent set, if every finite subset is linear. So they don't have any way of getting to infinite. For that you introduce this norm or convergence. Then that boils down to saying that if the sum, but if it is even worse, if you have an uncountable thing, you will talk about integral. Ft, gt equal to 0 for every g, it must for ft is equal to 0. That's the completeness aspect that comes into the picture. So that's what the moment problem is. If ft x to the power of t, t to the power of n is equal to 0 for every n, is t, ft equal to 0, if so, in what sense? All these questions are the moment problem. So they are all boiled down to analyzing functionals.
So for a Schrodinger basis, it will be true that the infinite summation is 0 if only possible.
Yeah, because of the fact that every factor has a unique expansion. Zero vector has one expansion. So that must be the only expansion.
That's it. Again, there you must say it is 0 in the sense of the norm. Suppose you put a L2 norm in the function space, and you are looking at the Schrodinger basis, when I say the function is 0, what I mean is the L2 norm is 0, which means f is 0 almost everywhere. That's the 0 vector of that space is almost everywhere 0 function. It's an equivalence class. Okay,
in that sense, you have to interpret in that norm sense. Okay, I think I'll in the right time stop. Any questions?
So the definition of Schrodinger basis is
yes. Every x has a unique expansion as summation. Yeah, you can show. Because of that finite linear combination, so that the norms are all small, getting smaller. In fact, basically, that uniqueness question was formulated by Ries. Actually, it should be called a Ries-Schroeder basis rather than Schroeder basis. But it's generally referred to as. But if you now come slowly to the present-day books, people are more interested in wavelets, so they start with Ries, they call it now, and what this is, Ries basis, Ries wavelets,
and Ries frames, all Ries's name come into the picture. Because Ries was the one who developed this entire analysis very nicely. So the questions of many such questions like this were very vague in the beginning. They were all sorted out, but Ries was one person who said that uniqueness expansion is one that you asked for. I'll say that this is short of questions, if every vector can be uniquely expanded as xi, ui, etc. etc. So the question about basis is a very fundamental question. It has connections with the functionals and there is a lot of questions, very tricky, subtle questions for which we still do not know the answers. But finite dimensional, now therefore should be treated as a trivial thing. So therefore, in a sense, linear algebra is a trivial subject. It has been trivialized. Compared to all these questions that arise here, everything can be answered very easily. So in that sense, it's trivialized. Only infinite dimensional spaces are interesting. Now if you see that the infinite dimensional space is also linear things, people are not very much interested nowadays. What is particular about linear? Non-linears are important. But non-linear theory unfortunately has not gone too far. It is very difficult to go too far. Basic doesn't come into the picture to help you. So we don't know what is the right language to speak non-linear analysis. A lot of things that are done, but there is nothing like a cohesive theory that's going on. In fact, one of my friends, an analyst, who himself does a lot of non-linear analysis, he has a joke. He says, if you take a paper, see a paper, I could tell this joke to many of my friends who do non-linear analysis. It's to be taken in lighter mind, not as a criticism. If you see a paper on non-linear analysis, don't read the first 8 pages, go to the 10th page. Because the first 8 pages, you will make, every author will make a lot of statements and formulate the problem and give a high funda non-linear formulation of the problem. And somewhere by the time it comes to 9th page, you would have linearized it. So that's where the problem starts. So it's a joke. I mean, it's a joke by a very outstanding nonlinear analyst. He said that really don't know where to go. Somewhere along the bank, we have to fall back upon linear analysis to get something out of it. So in the sense, therefore, a cohesive theory for nonlinear problems is very difficult because each nonlinear problem behaves its own way. So only a certain general statements we can make. But beyond that, a cohesive theory is extremely difficult. So there is a lot of open things that are available. Even to take a linear thing and slightly perturb it by a non-linear thing. That analysis itself is a singular perturbation of a linear thing. It is a very difficult thing to handle. Lots of analysis is available for that. So there, even in a very simple situation like a Banach space, question of basis, a lot of unanswered questions are there. Very, very fundamental questions which still keep going. So it taken 170-180 years. Banach was in the beginning of the 20th century. The question of the basis by all these things worked out by Hilbert, Ries and others by 1910, 1915. But it was finally answered in 75, 76, 60 years later. And Plou said, no, all your claims are wrong. There are Banach spaces which are separable and which do not have a Schroder basis. So therefore, it's all no open problem. What is again next set of open problems? What can then you say as the real criterion to determine the existence of a Schroder basis? All the standard examples I know, that's not the big deal. The big deal is what is the general theorem? What is the necessary and sufficient condition for a Banach space to have a Schroder basis? That full question is still open. It's complete.